She wears several hats, from civic engagement, creative writing, advocate on human rights, also heads a mentorship program at Siasa Place, and a champion for democratic literacy. Ms. Shefa Okore, thank you for joining me on the show today.
Thank you for having me.
Do you ever feel that you're spreading yourself too thin, all these responsibilities that you have?
Not at all. Not at all. I think when you grow into responsibility, like I have grown into responsibilities all through my entire life, it becomes second nature. So taking on more responsibility is never really about spreading yourself too thin, or never, you know, the way they say that you do so many things, then you become better at nothing. You know, but for me, it's second nature. Uh-huh. I do so many things, and I do so. The good thing about it is, I do so many things that I really love doing. Mm-hmm. Yes. So for me, it's very gratifying.
Yeah. Yeah. So then, at the end of the day, you feel you're happy with yourself.
I am. Then there are days I just want to run away and hide in a corner.
Why?
That is natural. I think for everything that you do, it's very natural. Sometimes you want to run in a corner and just hide and block the world away and just be by yourself.
Wow.
And get to rejuvenate your soul, so that you can wake up and give
more
it your all.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, so what are three words that best describes Shefa?
Three words that best describe me. Let's see, I don't want to be too biased. one is unapologetic, mm-hmm. uncensored, mm-hmm. and big-hearted.
You just got me curious. Unapologetic. By that you mean you're just yourself, and you don't have to explain yourself. You just
absolutely. I mean, mm-hmm. be yourself. Everybody else is taken. Mm-hmm. Be yourself.
And uncensored.
Uncensored means when you come to me, or when I come to you, mm-hmm. I come to you with all the truth. Mm-hmm. And it is not. I don't believe in sugarcoating things. Mm-hmm. Plus, I was brought up not being very exposed to sugar. You know, my mother said sugar's going to spoil your teeth, and I don't have money. For a dentist.
Yeah, so you don't know how to sugarcoat stuff.
No, I don't know how to sugarcoat it. That doesn't also mean I'm going to be disrespectful about issues. It just means that I am going to tell you like it is. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you might not like it. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you will. But at the end of the day, that's the whole idea of being uncensored. I think life itself cannot be censored. Mm-hmm. So why should we, ideally as human beings, be censored?
Why is it important for especially women mm-hmm. to know their worth?
Wow. Because the whole idea of existing as a woman mm-hmm. is to exist as a worthy human being. Because I don't think you ever realize how worthy you are as a human being until you know your worth. Until you know that there is a boundary. Mm-hmm. And this is what it means to mm-hmm. me, and this is what it would mean to someone else. Mm-hmm. So knowing your worth is equivalent to knowing what you are actually put on earth to do. Because if you know that you're created for big things and for phenomenal reasons and to achieve something big, why would you ever want to settle for less?
So a while ago you were sharing with me reasons as to why you entered into mm-hmm. the advocacy world. Mm-hmm. Could you kindly share with our viewers why are you so passionate about some of these issues like sexual violence mm-hmm. and all of that? When did it start?
I mean, it started way back. I'm just going to cut a long story short. It started way back when I realized nobody speaks for you than you. Or nobody can ever speak better for you than yourself.
Yeah.
Yes. It is impossible for me to even try to understand your situation unless you tell it to me.
Yeah.
But there is an assumption that I can speak for you from a point of misinformation, which is wrong. You have to learn to listen, and you have to learn to articulate. Two separate things.
Yeah.
So I learned earlier on in my life that I had to speak for myself.
But earlier on, when was that?
Earlier on, high school. Wow.
In high school, what happened in high school?
High school, when we used to have Sundays in my school.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. We used to have meat. Mm-hmm. And you only get one piece of meat.
Oh.
You know, you complain, but nothing would ever be done. You have
with
to
a
understand.
Lot of soup, I guess.
With a lot of soup and
fantastic.
Like a humongous piece of ugali, which would completely absorb all the soup, so there's no soup. So the ugali is soup of meat. So we used to have meat, and then this meat sometimes would stay in the school refrigerator for an entire 2 months.
Wow.
At some point it goes bad.
Mm-hmm.
And then even when you're served, the smell is different, the taste is different,
mm-hmm.
but you're not supposed to question authority.
No.
You're not supposed to even want to know why. Ideally, just eat and go.
That is food poisoning.
That is food poisoning, right.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I said, okay, so I am the one consuming this.
Yeah.
I should ideally have a say in what I consume. I know
if
I'm
anything,
not
you're paying. You're paying for the food.
Yeah, but by then, you know, you're a child. You don't even think of paying because they'll tell you it's your parents. So let your parents complain. Right?
But my parent doesn't eat you this food.
That's the thing, though. That's the thing that
so
I said.
So now you realize you have to.
I have to speak for myself. Mm-hmm. And it became such an issue that it seemed like I was really trying to show myself that, oh, I'm the tough one. I'm the know-it-all. I'm the one who feels I deserve better.
So what followed,
and
I'm sure.
Well, there were repercussions like punishments and everything. Yeah. But the good thing was the following week there was fresh meat.
Oh.
Yeah. Then I realized, talking works. Actually talking very loudly works. Mm-hmm. And talking consistently works.
Mm-hmm.
And ensuring that you speak to the right person also mm-hmm. really works.
Yeah.
Because I wasn't just quote-unquote shouting at open space. I reported it to the person whom I thought was responsible in that particular place. Mm-hmm. So yes.
So it was effective.
It was effective.
So from then on you realize it is important.
I realize it was.
It's not working.
Yes.
You
especially
speak
for me.
Because to the right people.
True. Because if I speak about it, then you also feel the need to speak about it when something is wrong.
Yeah.
And then we are all speaking about issues and making our society better.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And somehow we get my solutions.
Absolutely.
So tell us about your love for writing.
Wow. Love for writing is a very deep love.
How deep?
It is so deep. It is in the core of the person who is Schaefer.
Yeah.
So I love to write because you grow older and then you realize, okay, I am getting into this new space of my life or of myself, and you're becoming more aware. And as a woman and as a human being, you start responding to voices in your head, because I think everybody has voices in their head. And I started reading these interesting books, Chronicles of Narnia and Lord of the Rings and Prisoners of Zenda and Jane Eyre. And you start realizing that, wow, the only way I get to travel without struggling
is by reading. Exactly.
And then I was also very good in expressing myself verbally.
Mm.
So I started writing as a challenge to myself.
Oh, okay.
And I never allowed anybody to read what I read, because I thought, this is just
like
my noise.
Or something.
Yeah, like a small diary. Mm. Then they turned into little poems.
Mm-hmm.
Then they turned into like 3-sentence poems to a paragraph of just a story I am imagining somewhere, to now we are writing formally and officially.
Have you published any of your works?
My work is mostly online because I lead a writer's podium, and the writer's podium at Siasa Place is basically a podium for young writers, people who want to write, people who are aspiring to write, or people who hope to write one day.
So generally you mentor.
Absolutely. And specifically so in creative writing, because there are different forms of writing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I realized that the creative aspect of it was taken to be such a joke.
Yeah.
You know, because if somebody was to write a fictional story, someone else feels, oh, even I can't write a story about the cat and the hare.
And
but
why, you know,
absolutely, it's so different. Yeah, but it's so different when you talk about your cat and the hare, and I talk about my cat and the hare, and someone else talks about their cat and the hare.
Mm-hmm.
All these stories can be told. It's one story, but different voices, different attitudes.
Mm-hmm.
So my love for writing is very deep, and I think it's one of my escape modes as well.
So what inspires your writings?
Everything. Every single thing, even just sitting here, is a piece in itself that I can write.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Every single thing.
All right. So, what does human rights mean to you?
Human rights to me is life.
Mm-hmm.
Human rights to me is undeniably the one thing that everybody deserves.
Mm-hmm.
It is the opportunity for everyone to be on the same level.
Yeah.
No matter race, no matter gender, no matter social strata, no matter educational background, you know, human rights is to me the epitome of even democracy.
Okay.
Yes.
Do you think progress has been made in regards to human rights now compared to maybe 5 years ago, especially in our country?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And no. Yes, a strong yes, because I think now there are people like me who ideally were not the quote-unquote human rights people before, right? Because human rights in 5 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, it was meant to be for certain people who've gone to a torture chamber somewhere,
yeah.
you know, and have been somewhere. Yes, like you've had to, I've literally been dragged,
you know,
through
dragged
mad.
Through, yeah.
Yes. But
being beaten at a Uhuru Park somewhere.
Absolutely, and it is all a media
frenzy. Now it gives you a right.
Yes. Now you are officially baptized into the human rights thing.
Yes.
I think for that, I think for that is also great. And that is that kind of, that is a different kind of human rights.
Mm-hmm.
There's also the new human rights activist people coming up. And I use quote unquote because I believe everybody's a human rights activist, mm-hmm. right? Because if you want a better life, you want human rights,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So for me, I think that right now there is a space for everyone and, you know, everyone everywhere to occupy and speak up and stand up and be a symbol of whatever it is that they want, that they need to be better in society. So for me, that is a plus because it doesn't, you know, it doesn't limit the space to just a certain category of people. It becomes broader, makes it even easier to understand diverse issues, makes it even easier for us to get into easier ways of figuring out solutions. It makes it easier to even devolve knowledge about human rights and what it's about. Because, you know, when you talk about human rights in the high end, high up the pyramid, it's about terminologies and it's about a technical conversation. When you bring it down to the grassroots, it's about a mama mboga who just wants to sell a mboga by the roadside and doesn't want to be harassed by city councillor Sakai's.
Thank you.
You know? Yeah. It is about somebody hooking his or her groundnuts by the roadside, doesn't want to be harassed.
Mm-hmm.
So the awareness and the fact that now there is a space for all these conversations to be had yeah. is a plus.
Yeah.
And no, for me, is the fact that the more the space is opened, the faster it's also being shut down.
Oh,
you know?
Okay.
Yeah. Because now there's so many people talking about the same issues.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that we have so many people talking about these things means issues are elevated and issues are louder. And now you can't ignore it because it's not just maybe Miriam talking about it or Shafer. It is Miriam, Shafer, Salome, Kevin, you know, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
10,000 of us are talking about the same thing. Then it becomes a noise that maybe the person responsible for fixing doesn't want to hear. So now we see cases of, yes, now we see cases of, unfortunate cases of, yes. You see Willy Kimani, the unfortunate story, the lawyer.
The lawyer.
You know, people disappearing, bloggers or activists being arrested left, right and center. Why? Then you ask yourself, why? Why is that? Because Article 1 of the Constitution states that the power is for the people, you know.
Yeah.
It is for us. So we need to actually be happy because democracy doesn't just give us the ability for choice, but democracy allows us to have noise.
Exactly.
Democracy cannot exist in silence. So it is all good. It's a yin and yang situation.
And with that, in case you're joining us, my guest today is Miss Shafer Okore. She is a human rights activist and she's a writer and she's so many other things that you're going to talk about once we come from our short break. Don't go too far. Welcome back. This is the Exceptional Women's Show and I am Miriam Ogutu. And my guest today is Miss Shafer Okore. So before we went for the break, of course, you're talking about the human rights and your involvement in it and the passion that you have for human rights. And could you tell us about the Mimi Niwewe campaign that you are also involved in?
Mimi Niwewe is a beautiful, beautiful campaign. And like everything else that I don't do it unless it has my heart. And Mimi Niwewe touched my heart because I have worked with several women, several men, several children who have been sexually violated, you know. And violence, you know, violence has a lot of manifestations. From the verbal abuse to the physical abuse to now the downright, exactly, you know. So I have done that before and I have seen how the system becomes so... It is so populated by bureaucracy that it's impossible for you to even get access to justice, you know. And when Mimi Niwewe came to me from this wonderful lady, she had suggested that why don't we all come together? Because I know a couple of other amazing women in my group who do this kind of work. So she just wanted to put all of us under one umbrella.
Yeah.
so that it's easier for us to receive these cases. So I don't receive my cases in isolation. Someone else doesn't receive their cases in isolation. And then you're all struggling to help these people individually, right? So we come together, we receive all these cases together. And then from that very group of Mimi Nawewe, there are doctors, there are lawyers, there are psychologists, there are safe houses and safe haven. It's one stop for everybody. Yes. Yeah. Suffering any kind of abuse, you know, you don't have to wait until it is violent for you to come out and say, you know what, I feel or I think I need help. This is what is going on. So it makes it easier for even the victims to access the help they need. Because, you know, help is also victim specific. There's a victim who needs medical attention first, legal help after, and then psychological help later. Then even there's some who need financial assistance later, because most of even the victims have no financial ways of taking care of themselves. That's why they even stay in abusive relationships, both men and women. And Mimi Nawewe, when it came out, we were so excited because it made it easy for all these people to come together and work on one thing, so that we can actually end this violence.
Wow. So are some human rights more important than others?
Absolutely not. How? It is like saying my right to life is more important than your right to education. Or your right, my right to life is more important than your right to expression or your right to, you know, to be able to assemble. Human rights are human rights across the board. And I think they shouldn't even be debated about.
I know.
You know, they should never be. I get so amused and sad at the same time when I see people trying to make some seem more important than others. Then I'm asking myself, so does that make the other people less human beings?
than the rest.
Yeah.
So when you say equity in all matters when it comes to human rights, what do you mean by this?
I mean equity across the board in regards to access to each and everything that we both want, men and women. Men and women. And I'm talking about a woman being given what is due for her financially, in regards to opportunity, in regards to dignity, in regards to even the conversations she engages in society. Because I think sometimes it becomes an imbalance. When a woman is allowed to, I am lucky now, I think we are all lucky now and we appreciate that, that I'm not growing up in the kind of society that my mother grew up in, right? Where she was bright, she could go to school, but then you had nothing to do with that education because you belonged to someone else.
Or even you feel lucky to have gone to school, because not many women have to go to school.
Anyways. True, yeah. You'd be told, it's pointless because you'll still end up here. So my fight for equity is so that the opportunity that a boy child can get, the same opportunity a woman or a girl child can get. Because even now, in parts of this country that I have gone, because I work very closely in the grassroots, there are conversations that women still cannot have. There are dreams that a young girl cannot have. And it is impossible for you to become what you don't see. If you don't grow up around women who are working, who are ambitious, who are focused, who are striving to achieve,
it's very different.
You will not be that.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
So, it breaks your heart because there are parts of this country where young girls still cannot dream beyond being just
married at 12.
Leave alone even that, like just going to high school. That is, it's the end. Like they are not allowed to go beyond that. It's like there is a door that has been shut. It's the end. Yeah. Like even to just create, they're not allowed to do that. So I want equity in regards to even the opportunities given. I want equity in regards to even the value of skill that women bring on board, to the value of their time, to the value of their hustle, if I can call it that. Because most of the time, you even see women are suppliers. For example, you take a beautiful career like event organizing, suppliers, most of them, from catering to ABCD and all that, women. And they're the least paid. And they're the last paid.
The last, you know, paid.
Suppliers are always calling you after the wedding 3 months later. So what happened? Did you?
Seriously?
It is wrong. Yeah.
Yeah. So now, after that very heavy stuff, not very light, but do you have like secret skills?
Yes. I do.
Like what?
But if I tell you anyway, I do. I think I have a couple of secret skills. I draw.
You draw?
Yes.
Okay.
With pencil.
Paint or pencil?
With pencil.
Seriously?
Yes.
So you can draw like...
I can draw abstract stuff, mm-hmm. and then there's always the still life thing that where they put something in front of you and then you can draw exactly what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I can do that really well. For fun.
Oh, I want. You should rethink.
I know. So I should rethink my entire life.
So what's your worst habit?
Well, it shouldn't even say that loud. My worst habit is. I cannot sleep with my door open. Like my bedroom door has to be like,
I can't.
Yes, and then I am terribly, terribly claustrophobic. Like I can't stand small spaces.
Ah,
I can't.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, what is the destination for the trip you take? Like if today you have to go somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Where is that place?
Ah, wow. Morocco?
Oh, nice. It's a good choice. And they have a Versace castle over there.
See?
Good choice.
Good
choice.
Morocco is good.
It is.
Then I won't speak English.
What?
Do they speak English? They don't, right?
Actually, they do.
They do?
Somehow. They can communicate.
I want to go somewhere where I actually struggle to communicate. I don't know why. It just sounds interesting in my mind.
You are adventurous, I guess. And that's why. So what is it, the one thing that you never do again? You did it and you're like, oh man.
Apologize for being who I am.
Ah.
Never do that again.
Do you know the time I came to that point?
Mm.
You find that you have to always explain yourself.
Yes.
I feel like... No.
I am who I am for a reason.
Yeah.
I am who I am for a reason.
If you don't like me, that's
it's okay.
I'm at peace with that.
Yes.
But I think that also takes a lot of maturity.
True.
And once you know yourself, value and worth.
Yes.
You realize you cannot please everybody.
Yes.
And
true.
Not everybody's going to be happy or you know, with
all
you,
the
so
time, yes.
Yeah.
It is true. I can't. I would never apologize for being me.
So that's something you once did and you're like, no.
Yeah, I once did, and then you look back at it and you say you're sorry for it, and then you wonder, why was I sorry for being right in the first place? You know?
Well, sometimes you're forced to be politically correct, or you're trying to make peace, or
something I cannot do.
So, what fictional character reminds you most about yourself?
Me.
Like a Wonder Woman.
Like a Wonder Woman.
Yeah.
If I was to be a Wonder Woman. God.
For a day.
Wow, I need to think about that because I love so many and then pick one. Oh my God, I have always wanted to be, there are stories, let me tell you from an orthodox way, there are stories we used to be told when we were growing up about long, long time ago, and then there was this wonderful woman who used to take care of her kids and everything, and those stories evolved around how a woman was so powerful and a woman was everything.
Yeah.
I would want to be that. Because those
were that
narrative
is today. Women are the backbone of everything.
They are. But now the reason why I'm saying I would want to absolutely be that is because these women were made to feel like being that was a weakness.
Was a problem.
Right.
It was a weakness.
Yes.
Ah,
you know?
Yeah.
That all you could do was, you know, take care, you know the way we were told, a woman's place is in the kitchen.
The kitchen, yeah.
You know, but yet women never just existed in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. Women existed everywhere.
The random small industries.
Yes.
The villages.
In the middle of the night, when now the old man needs to figure out stuff, it is the woman that was the last resort.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. When men were going to war, and now things are just hitting the fan. It is the women who are taking care of the family. It is the women feeding the warriors.
Mm-hmm.
It is the women who were spies. It is the women who diffused wars.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
I hate to use this example, but Delilah, Solomon, something, the biggest man ever, the strongest man ever, right?
Yeah.
If I have my words right.
Mm-hmm.
What did she do? She might not even figure out where this man's strength is, you know? I think for me, it is appreciating that women have always been multifaceted just by the fact that you're a woman genetically.
Mm-hmm.
And that should be completely celebrated.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Not taken as something
now, yes. True.
Okay. So, have you learned something important in life so far?
A lot. Mm-hmm. Every day.
One thing that stands out.
One thing that stands out. I have learned that, I have learned so many beautiful things, but I have learned that we should tell our stories.
Mm-hmm. It's important.
It's important. We should tell our stories in our own words, in our own ways. As human beings, as brothers and sisters, we should tell our stories.
Let me ask, what do you miss about your past?
Well, I miss the whole idea of just waking up and finding out that things were done. And not knowing how things like that.
Sound like my 9-year-old.
I just wanted
waking
things
up
to
in
be
the morning,
done.
Breakfast on the table, clothes are clean.
Yes. All I knew was that grown-ups would just walk out, come back with money, and
life is good.
Life is good.
Yeah.
You know? I miss that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And lastly, what do you how do you organize your day, and do you have like routine specific things that you do to get you through the day?
I do the things I do religiously, so, and I don't change that no matter how busy my day gets, because sometimes I have back-to-back days that I don't even recognize where I am. I just I am.
Yeah.
So yes,
yeah.
The things that I do, I think I wake up very early in the morning. I'm an early riser now. I wake up very early, I think around 4 a.m. First thing I have to always do is pray. I think everybody needs to pray.
I think, and what have you been praying about lately?
I've been praying about courage.
Oh.
Yes.
But you seem to have it all together.
That's the reason why I pray, so that I can continue having it all together. Oh. I pray about courage every day. I pray about wisdom. And I pray that every single day I get to touch somebody's life and they always remember, oh, I once met someone who said something like this, and
that's
really
beautiful. And you're not selfish at all.
I am not.
Do you ever think about yourself? Because everything else you do is just about everybody else.
Let's just say I have people who
like
do that for
Paul's.
Me now.
Today I'm going to be selfish.
I don't have time.
All right, Ms. Chef Okori, it was really wonderful to have you on the show today.
Thank you for
having
me. I'm
really happy that in the midst of all your very busy schedule, you find time to come and be with me here today.
Absolutely, my pleasure.
I really appreciate it.
Absolute pleasure.
All right, and until next time, I'll see you later.